We're continuing our series of unlocking the mystery and the treasures of our inheritance. Today's lesson, we want to look at God's amazing love in the book of Hosea, and we want to see the blessings of the thorns. Do you think thorns in your life can be a blessing? They can. So we want to see how that can have such an effect in our life that it causes growth and maturity. First of all, we're going to be talking about Hosea. He is a prophet, and when God called him to be a prophet and to marry the prostitute, he's only about 28 years old. So he is a very young man, and he is a prophet to the northern kingdom. Remember, the kingdom has divided, and he is a prophet to the 10 tribes in the north. He prophesied just before the northern tribes are going to be carried off to Assyria, and they are taken captive and carried to Assyria in 722. Now, when you look in the Bible and you're reading, you're going to see the term Israel, and after they divided, Israel refers to the north. They're the 10 tribes. They are also in many places called Ephraim, because Ephraim was the strongest tribe, the main tribe of the northern kingdom. So sometimes you're reading and you see Israel, sometimes you see Ephraim, or you see the house of Joseph. All of those are the northern kingdom. So we have Hosea. Now, what is the climate of the country when he comes to Israel and he's prophesying to them? Murder, idolatry, and immorality is rampant in the land. That's all that is going on. Sound familiar? It is. But here where you and I live, don't you think we're probably a little sheltered from what goes on in other areas of the U.S.? Probably so. But in the nation as a whole, it's all murder and idolatry and immorality. And nobody seems to be interested in hearing the truth of God's word. Now, they're wanting to hear what they want to hear, but they don't want to hear the truth of God's word. Now, Hosea is commanded by God to go out and marry Gomer, who is a prostitute. She's a harlot. They have three children together, and the last two, he's not even sure if they are his. Now, what happens? They're married, and it's not long. She what? She loses interest in him. And she goes out and she leaves him and she begins to pursue other lovers. She's looking for other men, other things to make her happy, fulfill her, and satisfy her. Does that happen with many of us as Christians? Yes. Many people initially are so much in love with Jesus when they're first born again. But what happens after a while if they don't nurture the relationship, if they don't keep the relationship with him fresh, do they kind of lose interest? And we have the church at Ephesus, don't we? The church at Ephesus it was just routine, kind of monotonous. They were doing the works, but there was no love relationship with Jesus Christ. So that's what's happened. And then Hosea receives a command. After she has strayed in pursuing other lovers, and God tells him, you have the humiliating responsibility now. I want you to go back. She's a slave now. Go back, and I want you to buy her back. Was she already his? But he had to go redeem her and buy her back. Now, many of the prophets in the Old Testament, God had them teach their message and prophesy through action sermons where they did some crazy things in order to get the message across to the people. So this is a vivid picture of the way Israel was treating God. Israel was prostituting herself to the idols of the land and committing spiritual adultery. Was she married to God? Yes, at Mount Sinai. He gave her all the commands, and she said, we do, and we will. But it wasn't long to where they lost interest and they're off pursuing other things. So we see such a love story, the love story of Jesus and how he redeemed us even when we strayed away and left him. So we see Hosea's actions towards Gomer are God's relationship to Israel. He's trying to show a visual, a picture of what this was in their time. Hosea is to manifest God's love and God's patience. God's patience with all of us and His long suffering. And we see in Hosea an unbroken love from a broken heart. Don't you know his heart was utterly broken over what his wife was doing? So, what happened? How did we get all this spiritual adultery? Where did it come from? We are now several hundred years from Jeroboam. And let's not forget, you remember Jeroboam, who we had last week? He becomes the first king of the northern kingdom. And what happened with him? We're going to talk about his sin. Hosea is the prophet, and he is going to prophesy during the reign of seven kings. The northern kingdom winds up having 19 kings over about a 200-year period, and they are from nine different dynasties. If you remember, did God promise Jeroboam, "I will build you your own dynasty just like I am doing for David"? He did, and he said, "I will give you Israel." But we are going to see, because of his sin and his unbelief, his house was never built. And we have nine different dynasties. So during the time Hosea prophesies, five of those seven kings that he's prophesying to during their reign, what does it say about them? They continued in the sin of who? Jeroboam. Yet we are almost 150 years out from Jeroboam's reign. And who is it still talking about? Look at the legacy he has. These kings are sinning and walking in the evil ways of Jeroboam, who was evil all of his days. He made Israel to sin. And this is to show the spiritual climate of the land. If you know what it was like under Jeroboam, and now we have a king 100 years later, and the reference is he's just like Jeroboam, then you know what the climate of the land is. Now, if we put this in context, remember with Jeroboam, Solomon died. And then the kingdom was divided, and Jeroboam became the king in the north. Now, here's Jeroboam. God's given him some amazing promises. "I have a great inheritance for you. I'm going to build you a house. I will give you Israel." It didn't take long, though, for him to fall into unbelief and fear. And he's saying, "Wow, if I let all these people in the 10 tribes, if they go down to Jerusalem to offer their sacrifices and celebrate their feast days, if they do that, I'm going to lose power." Because he was afraid that they would go down to the southern part and that they would pledge allegiance there and not return to him. He should not have had that fear. What had God told him? "I will give you." But he didn't believe it. So remember, he got all of his men together, his advisors, who I remind you are just men. He didn't take godly advice. He's going to take men's advice. And what do they come up with? "We're going to establish a counterfeit religion, and now we will make it very similar to what God ordained." Now, if you make it blatantly different, people will recognize it. But if it's similar and has some elements, you mix some of the truth with some false stuff, people will follow it much more easily. So remember, he made the golden calves at Bethel and at Dan. He's seeking to achieve his own personal agenda. God has told him his purpose for his life. But what's he doing now? "I am going to pursue what I want to do in the way I want to do it." He put himself and his desires before God. And what do people do? They distort God. And they make him something that then they feel good about what they're doing, so they don't feel the conviction of sin. He has his own personal agenda. He's going to make sure that he keeps the allegiance of these people and he keeps his kingdom. So he distorts God and he changes the understanding of God. God is just. He's faithful. If I really believe he's faithful, would I be off doing my own thing? No, I would claim the promise. I would hold on to the promise and by faith believe that he will give it to me. Now, The key point here is, if in his worship time, were they worshiping? He set up temples, did he not? He had the golden calves. And he told them, he said, this isn't really an idol. We're not changing the name of Jehovah. We're just giving you something visible, something you can see and touch. So it makes it more meaningful to you. Now, if he really had encountered God as he really is, if you and I do, have you ever in your quiet time or in your praise music, you get a new glimpse of who God really is? Wow. When you really encounter God and you see the truth of who he is and his majesty, it should change my personal agenda. Have you ever come to the point in your quiet time when you come to this realization and your prayer is, God, all I want, I voluntarily get on that potter's wheel because all I want is to be like Jesus. I want you to transform me into his image. So when you see God for who he is and what he wants for you, the inheritance he has, and you keep focused on all this, your desires change. Your agenda changes, and you're not so interested in this over here or this over here, something you want to be doing, the things you're seeking pleasure in. All you want is to be obedient and for God to come and do his work in you. And you will say, I have said, I want to be on that potter's wheel because I want to be obedient in everything that you want me to be. Now, if you are sincerely worshiping, if he had truly been worshiping God, he would see God's glory. He would see the majesty of God. Have you ever been in your quiet time and it really hits you how sinful you are? The wickedness of your heart? And then, God, I can't believe that you want a relationship with me, that you will forgive me and cleanse me and have fellowship with me. He did not see this. If he had really encountered God in his worship of God, he would have wanted the kingdom to reunite. He did everything he did to keep it, everything he could to keep it apart. Because Hosea 1:11 tells us what? The unified kingdom was God's will. He wanted the kingdom to be unified. Now, when he would go to the temples he set up and the idols he set up, he never, ever encountered God, or it would have changed him in his temple worship time. He didn't have that relationship with God, or he would not have been trying to do the opposite of God's will. He set up idol worship, and he even took down the whole country with him. He didn't want any of Israel to have a relationship with the true God, or they would have left him. They would have gone back to the south to the temple in Jerusalem. So in his sin and his desire in his way to get everything God had promised him. You know, God gave me a promise. Well, I've got to help him out and make sure I get it. He took that whole nation down with him. Isn't it amazing that we can come to church and pretend to worship? Now, I got this quote from a pastor. He said, isn't it amazing how many of us can go to church and we are pretending to worship? Some people may even really get into the singing. They may be raising their hands. Do I think there's anything wrong with that? Absolutely not. But if that's the only time they're acting like they worship, then I have a problem with it. They need to come to that experience and that fullness in raising their hands in their private worship. It's not just out in public. I think your private worship should be an overflow into your public worship. That's what I feel. So he said, isn't it amazing that we come to church and we pretend to worship, but we're not really worshiping God? He says, we're going through the motions. And I agree that music can get people wrapped up into an experience. All right? I do believe that. But we walk out of there and we don't change our personal agenda at all. We leave just like we came in. And we leave and we return to our same lifestyle. People sit in church and they wonder about making their list in their head of what am I going to do later today? What do I need to be thinking about? I've got to do this. I've got to do that. I've got to go to the grocery store. You are not encountering God when your mind is not engaged in the truth of God's Word and in the worship of Him. Isaiah, we can go to Isaiah 6 for a picture of the power of true worship, where you and I can be gripped by the glory of God and be amazed at what He has actually done for us. When you see God in all of His holiness, it reveals your sin. It reveals your sin. And you're so willing to confess that and ask for fellowship to be restored. Isaiah said, "Woe is me, for I'm lost. I'm a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. But now mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And he says, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send? Who is going to go for us?' And what did Isaiah say? 'Here am I. Send me.'" I'm on board with your agenda. It's your agenda that is what is important. So, how did we get to this, all this spiritual adultery? Don't forget, we're going to talk about the sin of Jehu. He is mentioned in Hosea chapter 1. Jehu is another king who comes along. He's in verse 4 of chapter 1 of Hosea. Now remember, Hosea has how many children? They have three little children that are born into their family. God tells him what to name them. Were names very important in the Old Testament? Yes. So he's told to name your first little boy Jezreel. And here's what God says about it. "You're going to name him Jezreel because I'm going to avenge the blood of Jezreel." Jezreel was a valley that had a lot of bloodshed and a lot of dark, wicked stuff going on in the land of Israel. "And I'm going to avenge the blood of Jezreel upon the house of who? Jehu, who is the king of Israel." He's one of the kings. And he says, "I am going to cease the kingdom of the house of Israel." So what is he already telling Hosea to tell the people by naming this child? Israel is going to be no more. I'm talking about the 10 tribes, all right? Not the whole thing. Israel will not be anymore, and I'm going to destroy Jehu's line. Now, the name Jezreel can mean God scatters. So what was he telling him in this prophecy? "I am getting ready to punish, to scatter the nation because of its sinfulness." And this message is about 7 years before it actually happens. So God's giving them a warning. Now let's go back to Ahijah's prophecy. This was in last week's lesson. Do you remember Jeroboam's wife? And their little boy got sick. And he told his wife to disguise herself. Said, "I want you to go to Ahijah, the prophet." Who was he? He's the one that had the new robe that he ripped in 12 pieces and gave Jeroboam 10 of them. So the little boy's sick, and she goes to Ahijah to find out a prophecy for Jeroboam and the little boy. What does Ahijah tell her? "The Lord's going to smite Israel. He's going to root them out of the land, scatter them beyond the river, and he's going to give Israel up." He's giving the same message now in the naming of the little boy Jezreel, and it's about 150 years later. He still is going to keep his promise. And all of this is because of whose sin that started it? Jeroboam. And the kings are still walking in the wicked ways of King Jeroboam. Now, God had told Jehu, he is a king of Israel, and he was told to go destroy Ahab's family. Now, you remember Ahab and Jezebel. We all remember Jezebel. Well, the husband was Ahab, so now you know all about them. Wicked, 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 who destroyed a lot of God's prophets. So God says, "Jehu, I want you to go destroy Ahab and his family." He says, "Great." So off he goes, but he kills Joram. He goes down to the southern kingdom to Ahaziah, who is the king of Judah. Now, remember, he is in where? Israel in the northern part. He takes it upon himself to go down to King Ahaziah in the southern part, and he kills him and 42 of his relatives. Now, was that in God's command? No. And then he killed a bunch of people that were related to the Baal cult. What had God told him to do? Killed the house of Ahab. But he went way beyond that. And the execution of Baal's servants, well, that's probably in God's will, although it wasn't in that command. But his attack on what? The house of David. That made God very angry. He went down to the southern kingdom. Ahaziah is in that house of David, that line of David, and he killed him and 42 of his relatives. So God is really angry because he went too far. It tells us that Jehu continued in the sins of Jeroboam. Notice he went around killing all the Baal stuff, but he kept the two golden calves. I wonder, for the same reason that Jeroboam wanted them. I want to keep the people here so they don't go off to the southern kingdom. So God says, I'm going to avenge all that innocent blood that Jehu shed. And I'm going to put an end to Jehu's dynasty. Remember, how many dynasties are we going to go through in the northern kingdom? 9. Because all of them are wicked, just like Jeroboam. Now, this was fulfilled in 752 when Zechariah was assassinated. And he was the great-great-grandson of Jehu, and that was the last of the dynasty. So the dynasty ended with that. Now, the next little child that's born is Lo Ruhamah, and her name means no mercy. I will have no mercy, no pity, no compassion on the house of Israel. Because what am I going to do to the house of Israel? They're going to cease. It's going to come to an end. Now, he says, I'm going to utterly take them away, and who is going to take them? Hello? Good, thank you. Assyria. Now, what does he say, though? But I'm going to have mercy on the house of who? Judah, because it's the house of David. And he has an unconditional covenant with David in his house. He says, and listen how I'm going to save the house of Judah. I'm going to save them how? By the Lord their God. And he goes on to say, I'm not going to save them by the bow. I'm not going to save them by a sword, a battle, or horses, or horsemen. So, let's note here, the Assyrians have captured the northern kingdom, the 10 tribes. Are y'all staying with me?
Yes.
Okay. They've captured the northern tribes, and they've gone where? To Assyria. All right. So, now what happens? They've got their sights on the southern kingdom now, on the kingdom of Judah, which is the tribe of Judah and Benjamin, right? And this is the house of David. So Assyria decides, we're going after them. And so they go down into the southern kingdom, and they are able to conquer almost every little town in the southern kingdom. So they're feeling pretty good about they're going to take this kingdom also. And where do they set their sights? On Jerusalem. We are going after Jerusalem now. But the night before the attack, 185,000 of the Assyrian soldiers mysteriously died in their sleep, because who showed up? The angel of the Lord, which I believe is Jesus Christ. So he shows up, and in 2 Kings 19, it tells us when the surviving Assyrians woke up the next morning, there's dead bodies everywhere. So the king Sennacherib of Assyria, they go back home, and it says he went home to his capital of Nineveh, and he stayed there. I think I would too. Now, the third little child is born, and his name is Lo-Ami. And his name, God is saying, you are not my people, and I'm not going to be your God. Wow. Can you imagine God saying that? He says, you have been rejected as his people. But remember, this is to the 10 northern tribes. His unconditional covenant is with whom? The house of David. Now, he says, I'm going to destroy the house of Israel through the names of these three children. I'm destroying the house of Israel. No mercy. I'm going to utterly take them away, and you are not my people. So that's what God's message was. This is what Hosea is saying to the nation of Israel. The very next verse, the scene changes, and we see the grace of God spilling out on the pages. The very next verse, verse 10 and 11 and verse 1 of chapter 2, what do we see God telling them about the future? I'm going to restore you. The restoration of Israel is in the future. And he says in verse 10, yet the number of the children of Israel is going to be like the sand of the sea. Has that happened? Not yet, but it will be in the millennial kingdom. It cannot be measured or numbered. And in the place where it was said to you, you're not my people, in that place it shall be said to you, you are the children of the living God. What a great promise after all the negative that they have just heard. It says, then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel, they're going to be gathered together. They're going to appoint themselves one head, and they're going to come up out of the land. Great shall be the day of Jezreel. Now remember, a lot of negative has happened in Jezreel, but now it's going to be turned into a valley of peace and righteousness. Look at verse 1 of chapter 2. Now he's just given this marvelous prediction, and what does he say? Tell this to Ami and Ruhama. Why? Why? Why is that stuck in there and start chapter 2? I want you to notice he repeats the two names, but what is missing from the children's names now? Lo, which is a negative that means no. It's a negative connotation. So before he said, I'm not showing you any mercy, and I'm going to take you utterly away. I'm not going to be your God. But after his marvelous prediction about their future, he says, tell that to Ami and Ruhama without the negative no. In other words, compassion is coming back. You're going to be my loved one. You're going to be my people. He's projecting into a forward future time after Jesus returns at the end of the 7-year tribulation period. Israel will be God's people. Is there a time that they are going to recognize him as their Messiah? Right. When he returns, they will recognize it. So isn't that interesting, taking the low off? See, if I were just casually reading, I would have seen their lo Ruhama, lo Ami. And when I got to chapter 2 and said Ami and Ruhama, it would have never meant a thing to me. But it does now. Does now. Now, here's a key point. Despite God's discipline, he is eventually going to restore the nation. And he lets them know that. They're going to have numerical growth. They're going to have spiritual restoration. They're going to have natural unification and have an administrative centralization. They're going to have territorial occupation. They're going to have all the divine blessing. I have a question for you. Has any of that been fulfilled? None of it. Not one thing that I just said has been fulfilled. However, a lot of people say there will not be a literal kingdom. Did you know most Protestant denominations don't believe in a literal kingdom? Most don't. You can take the passages like we had and that we're going to have in the future lessons, and these are used to base a belief in a literal future kingdom. You can see all this prophecy stuff. Why is it put there? And it hasn't been fulfilled. How can people say that's been fulfilled? You do have some that say that. There is a literal kingdom coming where Israel is going to occupy the land in peace. They will experience all the blessings of God because he's faithful. He is faithful. That's the character in the heart of God that we see in these prophecies. He's going to be faithful. Now, if you don't believe in a literal millennium, this could be a question to some people that don't believe in it. You have to ignore about 1,850 verses of Scripture in the Bible. There are at least that many scriptures about the millennial kingdom. Most of them in the prophets. Isaiah has a lot, and we're going to be getting into more of them. How can you take a third of the Bible and rip it out and not pay any attention to it? The whole thing is very much, all of history, all of the Bible is moving toward Jesus Christ coming back and setting up His kingdom. That's it. Now, some people say it's already been fulfilled in history. I don't know how they get that, but some do say that, and some get around it by saying, actually, all these promises now are for the church because God's through with Israel. Oh, He has many passages. He's not through with Israel. And we will find that as we move into the next dispensation. Now, we have a problem going on in the land of spiritual adultery. We have seen it in Gomer, we've seen it in Jehu, Israel, and in Jeroboam. We want to look at the symptoms of it because it is a real problem. So if we look at the symptoms, starting in chapter 2 of Hosea, it talks about her adulterous look. We know what some of those looks are on people's faces, don't we? Okay, so we have an adulterous look. And in verse 2 in the NIV, it says, what is that adulterous look on her face? Well, let's see what it is. Proverbs 7 describes it to us and helps us to understand it better. The harlot who is cunning in her heart. And what does she think? My actions, my agenda is what's going to satisfy me. I'm not looking to God and to the Word and my relationship with Him for my satisfaction, my happiness, my fulfillment, my purpose. I'm looking to my own agenda. Now, she's accomplishing her own goals and her own agenda. And I will say, most of you have heard my testimony, and I will say for some of my life, especially in my 30s and maybe my 40s, that's where I was. Now, I was doing a lot of activity in the church, but I was still pursuing a lot of the things I wanted to pursue. You know, we pursue things we want to do for pleasure, right? But when pleasure takes the place of our relationship and being faithful to the Lord, then we have a problem. I'm not saying we should never have any pleasure. Don't miss the point. She's out accomplishing her own goals and her own agenda, but her actions are destroying relationships. We are told she is boisterous, she is rebellious, and her feet don't remain at home. Whereas in Titus it says the godly woman is a keeper or a worker at home. It says in Hosea 2:13, this adulterous look, she has a brazen face. She hides behind, wow, this slammed me in the face. She hides behind all of her religious activity. Woo! I don't know if that hit you as hard as it did me, but it hit me really hard. That is a feature of spiritual adultery when you're hiding behind all of your religious activity. And you know I did a lot. You can't tell, though, from the outside the true condition of a person's heart. When we go to church, we go through the motions, and we leave no different than we came. And we're immediately out pursuing our own agenda again. We just go through all the motions. In Jeremiah 3, 1 through 5, we have an example of Israel playing the harlot. It said, you had a harlot's forehead, and you refused to be ashamed. You weren't even ashamed of what you were doing. So let's look at symptom number one of that adulterous look. It says, you do not recognize God as the source of your life. You know, everything we have, everything we are, is because of Him. Everything. And He could take it away from us in a flash. But many of us, myself included, at times, we forget to thank Him just for the things that we have. Our health, our mind, all these things. Everything we have and everything we are is because of Him. In Jeremiah 2:27, it describes their sinfulness and it says, they had their own way. Now here is in Jeremiah 2:27. I'm going to read the scripture first, and then we'll talk about the illustration. He says, "To an image carved from a piece of wood, they say, 'You are my father.' To an idol chiseled from a block of stone, they say, 'You are my mother.' How many people call Earth Mother Earth? And they think of the universe as a living organism that either brings good upon them or bad. They turn their back on me. But then in time of trouble, they cry out to me, and what do they say? 'Come save me.'" Now, you see the man. These are modern stone and wood items. He has his car, the airplane representing pleasure. He has, you know, they have their animals. They have, he's got his laptop computer. There's just all kinds of things that we can give homage to, right? That can take the place of our relationship. And so we put so much of our happiness in these things, don't we? This gives me pleasure. I'm happy because of this, and I'm happy because of something else. So he has all these different things. I see the fish. He's gone fishing. You know, all these different things. The skiing, because he gets to go skiing. And then all of the things that go in the house. You can just see all kinds of things here that we look to give us our happiness. Now, they're temporary, right? They don't provide a lasting satisfaction. Ryrie, who is a commentator, says, "Tree and stone refer to things that they used in the worship of Baal. They looked to Baal to give them life and happiness." Do you remember who brought in Baal? Jezebel. She's the one that brought in Baal, the Canaanite god. Now, what do I look to for happiness? Sometimes people, especially in early marriage maybe, we look to our spouse thinking he is the one is going to make us happy. Moving on. We look to our friends. And we can be with our friends, right? And we can just be so happy and we enjoy our time with them. But if that's all we're looking to for our satisfaction and our happiness, what happens when you're not with them? You know, you can't. Shopping. I hear people say, "I am really down. I know what will fix it. I need to go shopping." You know, shopping therapy. Well, that may last for a little bit, but that's not going to give you the sustained happiness and joy that you need. Or people will say, you know, "I need to go do something for pleasure." Now, we depend on our own efforts trying to make our life work, right? I want to be happy. I want to be fulfilled. I want to have purpose. And when all the things we keep trying don't, then we expect God to come through. "All right, God, I've done everything I know to do and nothing's working. Now I'm ready to come to you." And that's the attitude that we have a lot. Now notice, when there was a drought or a famine in the land of Israel, what did they do? Who did they turn to? Baal, because he is the god of agriculture and nature. He's the one that's supposed to be sending the rains and so forth. So they depended upon him for their crops instead of turning to God. Symptom number two of the adulterous look. Have you ever been dry in your soul? Dry in our soul. Dryness. Jeremiah 3 and Hosea 2:3, the same punishment. What was withheld from the people? The rains. And they had literal dryness, literal drought. This is a symbol of the barrenness and the desert-like condition of our soul. I'm sure most of you have been through periods of absolute dryness in your soul. I have. Now, when we try to live by our own means, we're trying to work everything out. He says, "You are playing the harlot, and you're forsaking God. And their plans do not satisfy." Everything we try to do to fix our world, fix our problems, and nothing satisfies. And all of my efforts end up to what? Dryness in my soul. Now, how did they respond when he told them this, the prophet? Here's symptom number three, ingratitude. This is symptom number three of that adulterous look. They thanked the false gods for their blessings. They went out and thanked Baal and the other gods for their food, for their clothing, for their water. God will not allow us to enjoy his gifts and ignore him. He's the giver of it all. That is the essence of idolatry. Symptom number four, then pride rises up. They aren't grateful, and the pride takes over, and he says, you refused to be ashamed. Now, when their own ways failed, they didn't go back to God humbly. They didn't go back with that humble spirit or apologetically. They came prideful and angrily. Man, when I realized my attitude sometimes years ago, why are you letting this happen to my family? That's that prideful and angry response. Because bad things were happening to us, and instead of seeking Him, I was trying to fix the problems all the time. And then I just could not understand why it kept raining on our house. Symptom number five. Then, do y'all know that I was under a lot of conviction this week with this lesson? Wow. Then we had the attitude, we expect God to bless us. I'm your child. I do this. I'm at that church almost all the time, every time the doors open. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. We give heavily. Why aren't you blessing us? Such a bad attitude. They ask God, why haven't you blessed us? Because they don't see what they're doing wrong. They had that adulterous look. They refuse to be ashamed. They're ungrateful, and pride has risen up within them. Verse 5, God keeps telling them, you've had your way. You've been following your own agenda. Symptom number 6, anger, and you blame God. You know, when I lost my second baby, 13 months, I lost two. I was not very happy. Went into a pretty good depression then. And I remember the thoughts that I had. You must not think I'd be a very good mother. I remember this clearly because it still rings a bell with me. And that's, we get into the blame thing, blaming God for our circumstances. This is implied throughout the passage in Jeremiah and Hosea. And it naturally happens when a proud person doesn't get what they expect. Now, when God reveals to you your pride, it's a pretty humbling thing, and you'll probably argue with Him for a while. I'm not really proud. I'm not really a Pharisee. Did y'all hear Laura say last week on the radio, my mom is a self...
Yeah.
Self what? Self-ascribed Pharisee. Okay. She knew I had told her that, so I was just... My ears went, what? Okay. When a proud person doesn't get what they expect, we see all of these attributes come out in them. Now, Jeremiah's points. What has he made so far in Jeremiah? You have a harlot's forehead. You refuse to be ashamed. You don't see any inconsistency in your actions, and you're not ashamed. You still have the pride. You're angry, and you're blaming God for all of this. Therefore, here's our passage. Because of all of this, here's where we have arrived. God says, here's what I'm going to do to you. Because you've got the pride, you're angry, you're blaming God. Nothing I've done is humbling you. You still come to me expecting to be blessed and upset because you're not. Y'all have the picture? Just think of me years ago. He says, therefore, here's what I'm going to do. I am going to hedge up your way with thorns. Would you like to be hedged in with nothing but thorns every direction you go? That's what he does with spiritual adultery. And I know that he had to do this to me. Laura will tell you he had to do this to her. And I'm praying that's what he will do to many of the people in the box. I'm going to hedge you up with thorns, and I'm going to make a wall of thorns, and you will not be able to find your path. Everything that you do You're going to run into thorns and walls, and everything you're trying to do for your happiness to make everything work out, it's going to be futile and in vain. Now, you're going to pursue your other lovers, your other agenda and everything. Here's the promise. You shall not overtake them. Then he goes on to say, you are going to be out seeking them, but you will not be able to find them. So all of your efforts are going to be what? In vain, in this wall, this hedge of thorns. Then what will you finally say? I will go now, and I'm going to return to my first husband. That's what I did maybe about 9 years ago. I finally went home, and on my face, I said, I give up. I cannot. I have no control over this situation. And I had been hedged in by thorns, getting pricked on every side. Everything I tried to do was futile. And I had no control, no ability to change the situation. And that's when I returned. The relationship started. I began to get in the Word, and I began to grow. This grew out of all that. And y'all have seen the God's faithfulness. That's what we want for these people to return to the faith that they once confessed. Because she said, for then it was better with me than it is now. God causes our own methods to fail because He wants to lead us back to Him. Some of us take more thorns than others. True? Some of you are very pliable and you got it the first thorn. I didn't. So what's the secret of divine sufficiency to have everything we need of Jesus, where we have His peace, we have His love, we have His victory, we have His calmness, everything I need to have it? It's the end of myself. It's the end of me trying to do it, me trying to fix it. Surrender to Him, and my part is to keep my vessel clean, confess myself before Him, surrender to Him, and pray that He will conform me into the image of Jesus. God is going to use my difficulties and my thorns to draw me to Him. These thorns, many times, that we must endure are the very condition to have blessing in our life. Our reaction to the thorns. Now, here's a quote. There are times when God restores us to the things that we have lost through negligence, rebellion, or sin. And I can tell you, God is restoring many years that the locust ate in our relationship. For the Christian, these storms are a no-lose proposition. We've got to look at them. What is it you're wanting to do in me? What is it you're wanting to do in my life? What are you wanting to teach me? These storms help us to see the loose shutters, the missing shingles, and the rotten fence post that are in our lives. And they turn us back to the only one who can make all the necessary repairs. He's refining me. He's polishing me to make me fit to serve with Him in His kingdom. And Almighty God is the only one that can do this. God's going to use the thorns and the storm of the life to purify me. We all have a lot of rough edges that need polished and refined. He wants us to help us see who we are in Him. We need to see who we are. Our worth is in Jesus Christ. We need to recognize our own weaknesses so we will appeal to His strength. God, I can't do this. I need Your strength. How do I get Your strength? You surrender to me and humble yourself before me. I want to read you a brief little story, and here are the main characters so you can keep up with me. Jenny is a flower shop owner. Sandra is the grieving customer in her flower shop. Barbara comes in, who's one of the customers, and Phil, and we're talking about a Thanksgiving special. Very appropriate as we're talking about thorns and we're coming into Thanksgiving. So, Sandra comes into the flower shop, and her life has been very difficult. In fact, in the fourth month of her second pregnancy, she was in a tragic car accident which took the life of her unborn child. During Thanksgiving week, she would have delivered that little son. So she's grieving over her loss. She has just found out her husband's company is threatening to transfer him away from all of their family. Her sister called and said, "I can't come for Thanksgiving." Her friend, who was going to help her, infuriated her by telling her, "Your grief and your loss, this was just a God-given path so you can mature, so that you can empathize with people who will go through that same thing later." That's not what you tell a person who's in the midst of it. All right. Now, so she goes in to the shop, and Jenny says, "Good afternoon, can I help you?" And she says, "I didn't want you to think I was ignoring you." And she said, "I need an arrangement." And Jenny said, "For Thanksgiving?" She said, "Yes." She said, "Okay, do you want a beautiful, but just an ordinary bouquet? Or would you like to challenge the day with a customer favorite I call the Thanksgiving special?" Well, Sandra's curiosity was aroused, and she said, "Well, tell me about this Thanksgiving special." Sandra blurted out, "I don't really feel very thankful because in the last 5 months, everything that could go wrong has gone wrong." And Jenny said, "I had the perfect arrangement for you." Well, the doorbell to the store rang, and in walks Barbara, and she said, "I'm here for my order." And Jenny said, "I'll be right back with it." And she enters the store again, and she has this huge bouquet of all greenery and bows and long-stemmed thorn roses with all the roses cut off. And only the stems are in the box with roses and so forth, without the roses. And she said, "Do you want this in a box, Barbara?" She said, "Yes, please." And Sandra's just watching what's going on here, and she can't believe it. "Is this a joke?" And she said, "Who wants rose stems with all the thorns and no flowers?" She waited for him to start laughing, but nobody was laughing. So she said, Barbara said, "Yes, it's just exquisite. I'll take it, please." She'd say, "You'd think after 3 years of getting this special every Thanksgiving, I wouldn't be so moved by its significance. But I feel it right here all over again." Well, Sandra was just staring. She said, "Why so normal a conversation about so strange an arrangement?" And that lady that left, she asked Jenny, she said, "You gave her no flowers." She said, "That's right, I cut off all the flowers." She said, "That's what I call the Thanksgiving thorns bouquet." And Sandra said, "I can't believe people would come and pay for that." And she said, "Do you really want to know why people pay for it?" And Sandra said, "Well, I can't leave the shop without knowing why." So she continued. She said, "Barbara came into the shop 3 years ago just like you have come in today. She thought she had very little to be thankful for. She had lost her father to cancer. The family business was failing. Her son was into drugs, and she needed major surgery." Jenny said, "The same year I lost my husband. I had complete responsibility for this shop, and for the first time, I spent the holidays all alone. I had no family, I had no children, and I had no husband. So what did you do?" And Jenny said, "I learned to be thankful for the thorns in my life." She said, "Thorns?" She said, "Yes, Sandra, I'm a Christian. I've always thanked God for all the good things that came into my life. But I never said, why are all these good things happening to me? But when bad stuff hit, boy, did I ever ask him. And I had a lot of questions. And it has taken all this time for me to learn dark times are very important. I always enjoyed all the flowers in my life, but it took the thorns in my life to show me the beauty of God's comfort and his love." The truth is, Sandra said, I don't think I want to be comforted. I've lost a baby and I'm angry with God. The little doorbell in the store rang again, and in comes Phil. And he says, I'm here for my 12 long, thorny-stemmed stems. I figured as much, and I have them all ready. And she handed them to Phil. He said, my wife is just going to love these. Sandra is looking again, and she can't believe it. And she said, you're taking these home to your wife? He said, yes. She said, why? You know, you shouldn't ask if you don't want to know. He said, I'm glad you asked. And he said, 4 years ago, my wife and I decided we were going to divorce after 40 years. Our marriage was in a real mess, but with the Lord's guidance, we slogged through every problem by rotten problem. He rescued our marriage, and last Thanksgiving, I stopped in here at this shop and told Jenny about it. And she brought me this vase of rose stems, and it reminds me of learning from our thorns. Well, that's good enough for me, so I took them home to my wife on that day. And we decided to take each one and label it. We labeled each one for a specific thorny situation and gave thanks to God for what that thorn had taught us in our life. So Phil paid, and off he went. And he turned to Sandra and he said, I highly recommend the thorny special. Well, Jenny said, my experience says that thorns make roses more precious. We treasure God's providential care more during our times of trouble than in any other time. And she said, remember, it was a crown of thorns that Jesus wore so we might know his love and his redemption. Never resent the thorns in your life. Tears rolled down Sandra's cheek, and she said, I'll take those 12 long-stemmed thorns, please. Jenny said, I hoped you would. I'll have them out shortly. Thank you. What do I owe you? She said, nothing. Just promise me that you're going to allow the Lord to heal your heart. She said, the first year's arrangement is always on me. And she said, I want you to read the little card that I've attached to the arrangement. This was written by George Matheson. You need to read his story if you don't know it. He said, my God, I have never thanked thee for my thorns. I've thanked thee 1,000 times for my roses, but not once have I ever thanked you for a thorn in my life. I've been looking forward to a world where I'm going to get compensation for my thorn. But I have never thought of my thorn as a present glory right now. Remember our thorns and our trials, Paul said, they're working for us to achieve a reward for us in heaven that's greater than anything that we go through right now. So we can say, oh, Father, teach me the glory of the cross. Teach me the value of my thorns. What is it you want me to learn? And show me that I have climbed to you. How did I get to you and surrender to you? I got there by the path of pain. Many times it's the pain in our life that will draw us into that relationship with the Father. So we need to thank God for the thorns so he can turn our sorrows into joy and glory in the future. If we go on and we look in Hosea 2, verses 8 to 13, look at the things that she paid her lovers with. They're all going to be taken away because who do they ultimately belong to? Her husband, God. Everything belongs to him. And she gave reference to grain and wine and oil, but who was she giving thanks to? Baal. For all the stuff, all the things she enjoyed, she gave thanks to Baal. He was associated with their rains and the agricultural blessings in the form of their grain and wine and bread and oil. She never recognized God was the true source of her blessings. In Hosea 2:8, he says she didn't know who gave her the grain, who gave her the new wine and the oil. I multiplied her silver and her gold, and they prepared it all for Baal. They took things God gave them, and they used them to worship another god. In Hosea 2:13, he says, I'm going to punish her for the days of the Baals to which she burned incense. She decked herself with earrings and jewelry, and she went after all these other lovers. And what does he say? She forgot me. She forgot me. What's God's response? Verses 14 to 23, he's going to tell them of their glorious future when he's going to restore them. We see God's grace spilled all over the pages of the Bible if we just slow down and look for it. After describing their sin and bringing them out into the wilderness, making that hedge of thorns around them, we're going to see his mercy, and he's going to entice them back to him. He uses our wilderness experiences to what? Bring us closer back to him. Larry Crabb says that mankind has three areas of need. We have casual longings that are just for our comfort, our personal preference, like I don't want it to rain on my parade. That's a very casual longing. I don't want my car to break down. He says we have critical longings that are like for our family. I want all my family to come to Christ. I don't want my family to be sick. I want sick people to get well. But all of us have a crucial longing that can only be filled by a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the only thing that can fill that deep inner thirst. And remember, what satisfies your casual and your critical longings, it can never satisfy your crucial longings. Only Jesus can satisfy that need, that personal relationship with God. Most of us spend so much time and energy on those first two needs, we never spend much time on the third need of that relationship with Jesus Christ. And we don't have a clue. I didn't for a long time. Here's the key. If I will work on my relationship with God, what happens? He takes care of all the rest. Because he's in charge and I'm following his agenda. God is going to end chapter 2 in 6 I will statements of promise to them, and we'll go through them quickly, except there's really 7. So we have 7, except I forgot to change it on this slide. Number 1, he says, I will. Therefore, behold, I'm going to allure her. And where's he going to take her? Out in the wilderness. He said, I'm going to lead you in the wilderness, and I'm going to speak tenderly to you. You know, in the wilderness is where we always get to the place where we recognize and we know he's all we need. Because there's nothing else out there. It's always good for us to go there. He doesn't force his people to love him. As a lover, he woos them like a beloved seeking her hand. He will lead you and me into the wilderness, so I'll be dried up in my own resources, just like the night I said, I give up. Everything I've tried is not working. I can't fix it. Only you can fix it. And we're more likely to turn to him. Just as he led Israel through the wilderness and he married her at Mount Sinai, he is going to meet his beloved in the wilderness in the last days when he returns at the end of the 7-year tribulation period. And he's going to lead them into her land that he promised Abraham. And he is going to lead them into the glorious millennial kingdom. Now, what's the result of being in the desert? He speaks kindly to her. Being in the desert makes us much more receptive to God's kind words. Number 2, he says, I'm going to give her vineyards from there. Remember, it's been barren, it's been desolate, and there's been drought and famine. So now he says, I'm going to give her vineyards there. And he's guaranteeing them that he's going to return them to their land and restore all the prosperity that they once had. He says, your valley of Achor, you know what your valley of Achor is? That's where things were desperate. Dark things happened there. Lots of sin, lots of bloodshed. He said, I'm going to make your valley of Achor a what? A door of hope. You're going to find hope out of all of these dark trials. The Valley of Achor in the Bible was where Achan sinned. Do you remember him? They went in the promised land. Joshua is in charge. They were told not to take any of the idols and so forth and the silver. And Achan took it. Do you remember? And it's a very bad memory. He took it. Remember, he buried it in his tent. And they go out. Joshua didn't know it. They go out to defeat the people at Ai. And what happened? Israel had a shameful defeat. It should have never happened. And then Joshua found out about the stolen articles. And what did God tell him to do? Take Achan, his family, and all of his animals, take them out on the edge of town, and you stone them to death. Wow. But they did it. Israel is now right with God again. They go and they have a great victory. Their valley of Achor, where that happened, became a door of hope, and they had victory. Now, he says, I'll erase that memory from your mind. God turns our defeats, all of the defeats that we feel, he can turn them into a time of hope for you and me. Our valley will become a door of hope through which Israel will enter a new life. That valley where all that happened in the valley of Jezreel, that's where he's going to bring them to, and that all is going to be turned into a door of hope as he sets up his millennial kingdom. It says she's going to sing there as in the days of her youth. When was she young? Just barely out of Egypt. Remember, she sang the song of Moses after they came up out of the land of Egypt and crossed the Red Sea, and they were giving praise and singing and dancing to the Lord. He had given them victory. You threw the rider into the sea. So they had a great song. In Revelation, we're told that they're going to be singing whose song in heaven? It's the song of Moses again in Revelation 15:3. And they're going to say, great and marvelous are your works, O Lord God, and true are your ways, King of the nations. When you and I worship God by song, reading his word, praising his name, our focus should be so much on him, his awesomeness, his holiness, his majesty, that we forget ourselves and our problems. We are just drawn into his presence. He says, your valley of Achor, it tells us in Isaiah, that valley of Achor where all that bloodshed happened, it's going to be a place for the herds to lie down for my people who have sought me. And he's going to restore all the vineyards. Number three, he says, it's going to be in that day, says the Lord, you're going to call me Ishi, which means my husband, instead of Bailey, which means my master. They both mean husband. He says, I'm going to take from your mouth the names of all the Baals, and they shall be remembered by their name no more. He declares when he brings them, there's going to be an end to idolatry. No more mention of anything connected with Baal. You will no longer call me Bailey in Hebrew, but you're now going to change it and call me Ishi, I-S-H-I. Both mean my husband, but Ishi is in the family. It's the family way to call him my husband. Bailey is the legal way to call him my husband. So he's going to change it from a legal thing to a family thing. Now, he wants to avoid any hint of a former lover. Number four, in that day, I'm going to make a covenant for Israel with the living creatures of the open country and the birds of heaven, with the creeping things on the ground. And he says, I'm going to break the bow, I'm going to break the sword, conflict out of the land. All of this is millennial talk. All of this refers to the millennium. He says, I'm going to make you to lie down safely. I'm going to restore the creation. There's going to be peace among the nations. Number five, notice he says three times, I'm going to betroth you. I'm going to betroth you to me how long? Forever. I'm going to betroth you to me. Look at the quality of it. Righteousness, justice, steadfast love, and in mercy. And then I'm even going to betroth you to me in stability and in faithfulness. Three times he promises them he will betroth them. You will know. The Amplified says you're going to recognize, you're going to give heed to, you are going to cherish the Lord and have everything that you lacked during the separation. Number six, in that day I'm going to answer, says the Lord. I'm going to answer in the heavens. They're going to respond to the earth. The heavens are going to send the rain. The earth is going to bring forth all this produce. We're going to have a restored universe. Sin and death will no longer reign. I know I'm rushing, but I'm trying to get done. Number seven, why do I give you this lesson printed with all the scriptures? So you can take it home and study it. Okay, great. Now, number seven, I will sow you to me in the earth, and I now will have mercy upon you, and I'm going to say to them who were not my people, you are my people, and you're going to say, you are my God. Remember Jezreel, the first little boy born? His name means God scatters, but it also means God sows. So in their punishment, He scattered them outside the land beyond the river. But in His restoration, He's going to sow and He's going to plant Israel back in their land. All of God's blessings are going to be restored, and we will all be in the millennial kingdom of Jesus Christ.